of the village is that, you know, adults have a tendency to be combative and competitive with the youth. Like, I've seen some people that be like, yo, I'll fight you and all this other stuff. And I'm just like, yo, that's not even, you know, some of us, we turn ourselves into the youth. And then before you know it, we're not teaching these youth anything by wanting to throw knuckles with them just because they're disrespectful. I've had guys that was disrespectful, and I pulled them over in a hallway at an alternative school while I was teaching my program and said, come here, and made sure that they apologized right there to the teacher that they was being disrespectful, and then, you know, grab them by the ear and say, come here, man, let me talk to you. And don't you know, and I ain't got to throw knuckles with them. I ain't got to be competitive with them. I ain't got to feel like I they're challenging my manhood or nothing, because I'm getting ready to teach them the way an older brother or, you know, even a father figure or a role model should, and let them know and look them dead in their face. Look, you know, I'm not fearing you right now, because I'm dealing with you, you know, in a very calm way. That's not my fear. What it actually is my courage to get you to go the right direction. And so what I chose to do after they took the funding away from our program is to make an impact with my art, with my creativity. You know, I'm not an angel. I'm not perfect in the movie world. I'm not perfect in the television world as a filmmaker or actor. But there is going to be some content that I put out there that has a message, and I use my own life. Can't nobody tell me how to use my life story. I'm gonna use my life story to make a change. I'm gonna make my life story make an impact. So I always equate it to the movie 8 Mile, when Eminem was up against something and he didn't know how to win the battle because he knew that they was gonna come at him. And he knew, you know what I'm saying, the leader of the free world was going to come at him and try to talk about him, you know, being all sorts of messed up and all that. So what he did, he turned around and flipped it and started talking about himself and won the whole freestyle. So I tell people, I talk about myself first before anybody gets the opportunity to talk about me. Because now, once I throw my whole life story out there, it's a ministry for somebody. It's not only a ministry for somebody, but I done blocked your opportunity to tear me down with my life story, my own life story, whenever I get to where I need to go. Yeah.
And one of the things that you've always been proud of, I know, is that you and some of the people that reach out to you, even though you might not even know them when they were in the system. Like I mentioned earlier, I know that one of the people that I've known you always admired was Bob and Chuck Davis, who actually, with the time you were in the system, would come and get you.
Yeah, may his soul rest in peace, man. That was an awesome person, man. Baba Chuck noticed me at an event one day, and I was coming out on passes with two other awesome people. There was a Caucasian couple, older couple named Mary and Gabriel Dehane. So they took me to an event one time at the Durham Arts Council on a pass from prison. And I went to the event, and Baba Chuck looked at me. Somebody had introduced me to him. He looked and stopped, and he said, your vibe is just like, your aura, it speaks nothing but creativity. He said, I want you to do me a favor. He's like, when you go back, I want you to look up this instrument called the akanting, which is the predecessor to the banjo. It's a West African instrument made from a fruit gourd. And he said, we're getting ready to do this piece called Bluegrass Brown Herb, where they're fusing bluegrass music with African dance because of the accounting. And it was the evolution of the accounting that turned into the banjo. So I went in and I researched it. And that night I wrote a poem about it right away.
Wow.
And I called him collect. He told me that before I left. He said, make sure, here's my number, call me collect. Called him collect, and I spit the poem to him. And he went crazy. And, you know, he was like, oh, my God, Michael. You know how he talks. You know, he was a gentle giant. So he was like, Michael, that is so outstanding. And then he just, you know, took it upon himself to become my sponsor as well. Him and Brother Hanif started, you know, they was like tag team and becoming my sponsor so I could come out. And I became the only inmate in the state of North Carolina that was coming out doing performances at places like Carolina Theater and, you know, Durham Arts Council and so many other places, Reynolds and all that. So it was just like, you know, he took on the leadership role of becoming one of my mentors because he knew I was an entertainer at heart. And he was trying to, you know, prepare me for the entertainment world because he knew there was a lot of snakes and sharks and stuff out there. So he was trying to get my skin a little tougher, but at the same token, make sure that my temper wasn't there coming home from prison, because he knew that I was going to encounter some challenges when it came to fickle people.
Oh, yeah, and I'm sure you've encountered those challenges, because I know that you've been involved in the arts. And we both know that the art scene, whether it's here or nationally, can even to this day still have a lot of fickle folks that don't want to give you the kind of respect that you should get, not just because of your background, but just because a lot of times they don't like to give respect in general.
I know. And, you know, you got people sometimes that will try to not even see your worth. They'll try to play you because, you know, you'll create your worth, you'll demand your worth, or they'll try to take your kindness for your weakness. And, I mean, in so many different ways, and you find yourself in certain situations where you don't know if you're right or you're wrong because you make a certain decision to kind of like, you know, say, okay, hold on. Did this person just try to play me? Are they disrespecting me or whatever? And so the decisions that you have to make, you know, in the moment, man, just become so challenging, and you have to create your freedom of thought in the very moment that you think somebody is trying to violate you. And it happens in so many different ways. It happens financially. It happens, like, you know, audibly. You know, people will try to say crazy stuff. And there's so many traps out there. And you just have to be – you have to have that discernment. And you have to say, okay, if I walk away and I let this one go, a greater opportunity is right around the corner. I know it is. It's got to be, because right now I'm being tried to see how I react. And so Baba Chuck Davis taught me, he said, don't ever get stuck in the moment to miss out on a lifetime. And I was like, yo,
right.
You know, that piece of advice stuck with me. It stuck with me. And, you know, like I said, you know, when he passed away, there was a succession of people passing away. The Caucasian couple I was talking about, they both passed away. Baba passed away. My best uncle passed away. And then my mother passed away right behind that. And all of that, that whole string of people passing away within a year and a half time had a major impact on me, to the point of right now that all I have to hold on to is the advice that they all ever given me. You know what I'm saying? And it just puts me in a situation, man, where I'm more of an introspect now than I've ever been in my life, even when I was in prison. I have to go places like to the river or to an ocean or something and just sit down and think and get my head together and just listen to the advice that was given by my elders, by these elders, these great mentors. I had to listen to it over and over again in my head and play it like a tape recorder.
Oh, yeah. What were some of the other great pieces of advice that you felt that you got when you were in the system or just in life in general, that not just from Baba Chuck, but maybe from your mom or that uncle you were referring to, but what were some of the really important pieces of advice that you got that you feel are pieces of advice that you try to share with others?
My mom, one of the things that she always told me, she said no matter how gray or black your skies are, just make sure that your face is always sunny and blue. And what she meant by that was to make sure that I'm always smiling no matter what, to be happy even in the worst moments. And, you know, I took half of that with me because my mom was good at doing that. She was real good at doing that. So I was halfway decent at doing it. But that piece of advice, it's something that sticks with me to this day, man. You know, I don't let people dictate my joy. I may have people that influence my emotions, whether it's in a positive way or a negative way. You know, because when you attach yourself to people, it's hard not to let your emotions get involved or your feelings get involved. But I do know that I've allowed myself to be a much more different person based on that piece of advice that my mom has given me. And then outside of that, I mean, you got to think about this. One of the pieces of it, I have a mentor that's in the film industry. He's one of my greatest mentors right now. He always makes sure that I don't go astray in L.A. And we constantly talk. If he's in New York, I'm in New York, I'm there. If he's in North Carolina, I'm in North Carolina, we're together. If I'm in L.A., he's in L.A., we're together. But the great Oba Babatunde is one of my best mentors out of the industry, and he has taught me so much. And one of the things that he taught me about the film industry and the acting industry, he told me this. He said, remember, at the end of the day, when you walk away, you're walking back to your reality, away from a non-reality. So don't let that non-reality dictate any of your actions other than the fact that you need to be professional.
Yeah, that's some real powerful advice from a real significant actor here in our community. There's no doubt about that. Because you, like I said, now you've also just been really taking the nation by storm, because I was checking your Facebook post, and you just mentioned that you got a recent announcement where something was going on where I think you're going to be directing a major production next year, and it's going to be like with a SAG actor. You didn't name who the actor was, so you don't want to name him now. You don't have to, but I would just say, wow, Mike is still.
Yeah, it's a major project. It's definitely a major project. It's going to be in L.A. It's going to be a SAG full feature film. And I'm going to have the opportunity to, you know, be a director and make sure that this production comes to life. And, again, you know, it's from a very powerful person in my life that allowed me to be given this opportunity. But, you know, it ain't but so much I can disclose based on, you know, a non-disclosure agreement I already signed and some other things. But it's going to be an awesome project, man. Like I said, you know, I get closer and closer to great projects as each year passes. Just did that one major documentary about East St. Louis that premiered at Tribeca, and shoot, the executive producers on that was Vince Vaughn, you know, the guy that played it. He used to be with Jennifer Aniston. He used to be Jennifer Aniston's fiance, and then the other executive producer on it was Peter Billingsley, which is Ralphie from Christmas Story, the You Shoot Your Eye Out guy. And so, but you know. To be under the umbrella of people like that lets you know that, you know, great things are happening. You're on the right journey. You're on the right path. And, you know, even with my acting, you know, I'm on a lot of TV One television shows. I'm in a movie called Crossbreed coming out with Vivica Fox and Daniel Baldwin. That's coming out soon. It's a sci-fi movie. Did some projects with Mario Van Peebles, Superstition, they cast me as a Taliban insurgent. Done so many different things, man, that, you know, I was able to take that same energy that I used to put into the block all night, selling drugs and guns, and put that same energy into acting and focusing on filmmaking and making that my lane. Now it's my lane, and I'm going to play that lane till the day that I die.
Wow. And I know one of the things that you told me, which I found really interesting, was that, and you're right, East St. Louis has that reputation of being a rough area. I mean, they talk about Durham being rough. They talk about Newark and New Jersey, where Dean is at, being rough, but East St. Louis definitely has a real significant rough kind of reputation and everything. But you were letting me know that when you were at Haytide that time, I guess it was about 2 or 3 weeks ago, that you also got a lot of respect from the folks that were there because they understood that you were coming from their, like where they are now, but you had been there before. So they gave you a lot more respect than they might have given the average producer or something, even some of the people that were involved in the production, because
Yeah, relevance got me a lot of access in the streets out there, and I had a lot of respect, a lot of young guys that looked up to me, and even sought mentorship from me during the making of the film. You know, we had some young characters that was involved with it, and the film was so crazy that we lost some of them. Some of them got killed. I would leave, come back to North Carolina, and then when I flew back, I found out one of them that got killed. We got to go film their funeral, and, you know, we were losing good guys out of the film because they was living that rough street life, you know, just feuding with each other and just, you know, senseless killings, you know, just some of the stuff I was caught up in when I was young. And so I would come back and do my best to teach. And whoever I taught, you know, I probably reached about two of them, and, you know, it shows in the film at the end, but, I mean, everybody there was just so lost. I would go there for weeks at a time sometimes, man, and come back so depressed because the spirit of depression as well was just so strong, and it used to just get up in my system. You know, I'm a receptive dude. I receive things through my spirit, and if I get around some environments like that, man, it just had an impact on me to the point to where sometimes I had to catch myself and make sure I wasn't going into a state of depression or something, you know, because the skies were always gloomy. The weather over there in the wintertime was cold and rainy all the time. And, you know, everybody was dying. Everybody was killing each other. And then poverty over there is just so blatant. You know, 50% of the homes over there are abandoned and gutted out and burnt down. It seemed like it was a war zone. It seemed like it was a post-war zone and people were trying to get their lives back together, man. So, you know, with all that being said, I will say this, man. Life is beautiful, even though sometimes it gets ugly.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And, you know, go ahead.
No, you're saying, and what advice would you give to folks that are other folks that are like maybe just in the